Previous problems for the government, like the huge herds of buffalo on the land, had now been taken care of. The government saw that many First Nations people were starving. Remember, with the buffalo gone, so was the First Nations' way of life. They thought the problem could be solved if First Nations people changed to a farming way of life. The government also knew that settlers needed the land to start farms. They made a plan that would help reach both of these goals. The government began talking to First Nations about making treaties. A treaty is an agreement between two nations. The government wanted to take the land for settlers, but made promises to the First Nations in return. The First Nations would move onto areas of land called reserves. In return, the government promised to provide food, healthcare, farm equipment, and schools. To the First Nations, a treaty is a solemn and sacred promise that would last forever. To the British, they were legal documents, but they were not sacred. The government believed it could own the land and then divide it into lots that settlers could farm. Both sides signing the treaty had different views for what was being promised. Each treaty was given a number. In the area that is Alberta today, three treaties were signed by different First Nations and the government. The treaties pushed First Nation people into smaller parts of their land. They were separated from their sacred lands and traditional practices. There was a loss of culture, language, and identity. Treaties cut the people off from their land they belonged to, from their families, from their language. They cut people off from their whole culture, from a whole way of life. It was the signing of these treaties, however, that allowed John A. Macdonald's vision of building the railway to come true. Yet there were still many challenges ahead. Can you imagine building a railway in the 1800s with the equipment that would have been available at the time? There were deep valleys where bridges needed to be built. There were swampy muskegs that the railway had to go around. There was the hard rock of the Canadian Shield and many kilometers of open prairie to cross. So many people were needed to build the railway that workers were brought from China. Some of these workers were treated very badly, although the railway could not have been built without them. They had no information about the country they were coming to. They didn't have the right clothes for the weather, and they were paid only half of what other workers received. The government was advertising the West as a place for homes for everyone, rich soil and nothing to fear. In reality, the West at the time was a dangerous place, with whiskey traders, wolfers, and without any law and order. The whiskey trader problem began in about 1865. They were men who came from Montana, an American state to the south. They came to trade furs, but they didn't trade with blankets, pots, or guns. Instead, they offered whiskey, a mixture of alcohol, pepper, and red ink. The whiskey poisoned many people, and the whiskey traders often took advantage of First Nations people who lived in the area. Another problem at this time was caused by wolfers. They were trappers who got furs by putting out poisoned buffalo meat to kill wolves and coyotes. Then a group of wolfers did something no one could forgive. They were searching for some missing horses in the Cypress Hills. They came across a group of Nakota who were camping peacefully nearby. Although the Nakota had not taken the horses, the wolfers attacked them, killing 30 people. The government in Ottawa knew it was time to bring law and order to the West. In 1873, the government set up a police force called the Northwest Mounted Police, later becoming the Royal Canadian Mounted Police. The first group of police trained in Manitoba. In July 1874, they began a long trek west. The company formed a line about 4 kilometers long. It included 275 armed men, 114 Red River carts with Métis drivers, field kitchens, mowing machines, plows, 339 horses, 142 oxen, and 93 beef cattle. The Northwest Mounted Police followed a British approach to law and order. Their red coats reminded everyone of their connection to Britain, whose soldiers also wore red uniforms. Their arrival began to change Alberta's identity. The British influence was growing stronger. Today, they are seen as a symbol of Canada around the world. Treaties were signed, a railway was built, and settlers were arriving to a safer Alberta. Imagine what it would be like to move halfway around the world to a place you didn't know, where people spoke a different language. You learned about how the Aboriginal peoples and the government had different perspectives about owning land. The settlers, too, brought new perspectives. For thousands of years, the First Nations people had shaped their way of life to suit the land. They had lived with nature. Now, the European settlers were clearing the land. They were cutting down trees and plowed the soil. They changed the land to suit their way of life. Some Aboriginal people, too, adopted that way of life.